and the conception of water in the Old and the New Testament. Now, we've got to begin by saying that this theme sets us a task of almost impossible magnitude, because in the Bible, the word water is used rather more than 600 times. It's used more than 530 times in the Old Testament, and it's used more than 70 times in the New. And therefore, we can't look at this in vast detail. We can only look at it in the broad principles and the broad symbolism in which this word is used. Now, to understand the way the Bible uses the concept of water, it's necessary to think ourselves into a completely new world. It's necessary to think ourselves out of 1973 completely and to think of ourselves back to a time 2,000 years ago. In the world in which we live in 1973, water is one of the commonest things in the world. It's easily obtained. You simply turn the tap and water flows into your house as much as you can possibly use. But in the ancient world, water was so rare that they actually sold it. In Palestine, water was notoriously scarce. In Palestine, there's only one river that flows for 12 months in the year, and that is the River Jordan. At the best, the rest of the rivers were merely winter torrents, and the wells were few and far between, and not by any means unfailing. Now, to get this idea of what water was like in a time before our own, we don't need to go nearly so far back as New Testament or Old Testament times. We can think of it in comparatively modern times. In the year 1800, Glasgow's water supply consisted in about 30 public wells and about 30 other wells and pumps in country mansions, note, in Buchanan Street, in Queen Street, and in Miller Street. And in Glasgow, there were professional water bearers who brought it from the wells to those who could pay for them. If you couldn't pay for it, then you brought it yourself. Now, this meant that less than 200 years ago, things like cleanliness and hygiene didn't exist. See, Dorothy Wordsworth, when she toured Glasgow early in the 19th century, noted how dirty the citizens looked. And you would get that anywhere, because if you weren't wealthy enough, you had to fetch the water from the well yourself, perhaps for miles, and you might not be wealthy enough to pay when the pony carts came round with the water at a halfpenny a stoop. The poor people couldn't pay for that. It was not until 1955 that there was parliamentary assent to the Glasgow Water Bill. In 1859, water came to Glasgow at a cost of £1,500,000, a colossal sum if you'd put it in terms of ancient currency. Well then, we've got to rethink this business of water altogether. Jerusalem was notoriously waterless, although Hezekiah was famous for building the conduits into the city, as we read in 2 Kings 20 and 20. Water was piped in and it was stored in cisterns, but water was actually sold. H.B. Tristram, in his book Eastern Customs and Bible Lands, talks about sitting in the ragged shelter of the bamboo and matting shelter and hearing the sonorous and ceaseless cry of the water bearer as he perambulates the narrow streets. Ho, every one that is athirst, come, in the name of the prophet, come buy and drink, taste, be thankful, and pass on. So when you think of a civilization, a society, a situation, which you had to buy water, which water is as scarce as that, then you've got to think of yourself out of the present way of looking at water altogether. In Isaiah 55 and 1, there's the dream of the prophet of the time, when water will be free, an incomprehensible dream in 1973. Now, when you think of water in this particular way, certain things arise. First of all, a well would be a most precious possession. That is what Caleb's daughter wanted for her dowry in Joshua 15 and 18. She asked her father for springs of water. And secondly, wells were so precious that people went to war about them, as did the herdsmen of Gera and the herdsmen of Isaac in Genesis 26, 17 to 27. And before that, Abraham and Abimelech in Genesis 21 and 25. And in wartime, it was an accepted act of hostility to fill up a well, as the Philistines did in the days of Abraham in Genesis 26 and 15. This was the kind of equivalent of a scorched earth policy in modern times. You destroyed the wells, and it was the most dangerous thing you could possibly do. Now, the result of this was that the village gathered round the well. Where there was a well, a village inevitably arose. And in the village, or nearby to the village, the well became the social center. For instance, when Saul and his servant were seeking for Samuel, in 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 11, it was from the girls on the way to the well that they asked of news where Samuel was. When Abraham's servant went to find a wife for Isaac in Genesis 24, it was to the well he went. And the well became the social center of the village where everyone met every day. The traveler, he knew where the wells were, and the traveler, he carried his leather bucket with him. In John 4 and 11, the Samaritan woman says to Jesus that he has nothing to draw with. She means he doesn't have the standard little leather bucket which the ordinary traveler would have with him. Well, they came, and day and daily, they drew the water from the well. And it wasn't like turning a tap and the water gushed in. It was often just a little trickle of water that came from the well, and so they had plenty of time to sit or to stand and to talk. And he came and they filled the water into their pitchers. The pitchers were of two kinds. They were the broad base pitchers, which were carried in the top of the head on a little leather round cushion. Or there was the pointed type of pitcher, which was carried on a pad on the shoulder or just behind the shoulder and pressed to the shoulder. When they brought the water home, it was put in the home in earthen pitchers. And sometimes the water that was required not for drinking but for cleansing purposes was put into great pitchers which were buried in the ground, which hold anything from 20 to 30 gallons. This is the kind of thing you read off in John chapter 2 and verse 6, when you read about the turning of the water into wine at Cana of Galilee. And again, not only did they go to collect the water for drinking and for cleansing purpose at the well, it was at the well that every woman went to do her washing. And so at the well, you had a fire often kindled, a big kettle going, or a little oven going, or a little place where they boiled the water going, and the clothes were washed and the women talked. Then again, it was at the well that they watered the cattle. And in order to water the cattle, there were troughs, stone troughs beside the well, as we read in Genesis 24 and 19 in the Rebecca story, when she offers to water the camels of Abraham's servant when he had come to look for a wife for his master's son. And in connection with this, a request for a drink of water was very common. It was quite common for a stranger to come up to someone who was at the well or leaving the well and to ask for a drink of water. So we get Abraham's servant doing this in the Rebecca story in Genesis 24 and 17, and we get Jesus doing it with the woman at Samaria in Genesis 4 and 7. Now, in addition to the ordinary wells, there were at least other two things. There were mineral springs. For instance, we read about the Pool of Bethesda in John 5, 2 to 4. And we read about the Pool of Bethesda being every now and again troubled. An angel troubled the water, and then the first person down into the water after that was healed. And it was very common in these mineral pools for there to be an ebb and flow of the water. There still is in the mineral springs that are left, and this is what is being talked about. In addition to that, there were cisterns. And even, not only in the cities were cisterns, there were cisterns in the desert. Great big brick earthen-built cisterns where the water might be collected. Well then, the Oriental valued water. And because of this, the Oriental liked to sit and look at water. And often he had a pool in his garden and sat and looked at the water as being a very beautiful thing to look at. One of the interesting things in the ancient world is, and it comes into the Bible in another connection, is that they were connoisseurs of water. H.G. Van Lennep wrote a very interesting book called Bible Lands, Their Modern Customs and Manners. It's dated back to 1875. It was, of course, modern when it was written, but there are still things which are true in it. Now, Van Lennep speaks about the different characters that different kinds of water produce. He speaks about the character of the mountaineers, who drink the water which has come straight from the perennial snows, and he says, that kind of water has a kind of electrical effect upon a man. And he speaks about the people who drink the muddy waters of Mesopotamia and Egypt, and in this case, they're sluggish in body and in mind. And one very interesting thing he says is this, I quote, he says, there are in Constantinople in 1875 shops where nothing but water is sold, and the price of a glass varies in accordance with the reputation of the spring from which it is brought. And nor would it be easy to deceive the customer. The water of a spring near Nicomedia is often conveyed to Constantinople, a distance of 60 miles by water, for the use of the pashas and the grandees. And a steamer regularly plies between the capital and the island of Marmora, 75 miles off in the sea of that name, in order to supply the Sultan's harem with the water of a celebrated spring. So in the East, there were connoisseurs of water. They could tell you from what well water came, and there was star water and not so good water. And this is the background of the story of David. In 2 Samuel chapter 22, verses 15 and 16, crying out for a drink of the water of the well that is by the gate. This is a perfectly natural story under ancient terminology. Well, and now, let's begin to look at the more definite symbolism of water and the word water in the Bible. And the very first thing we must look at, the first point is this. We must first look at the meaning of the word thirst. And to put it quite simply, in 1973, in Britain or in the Western countries, nobody really knows what it is to be thirsty. See, as I've already said, we've only got to turn the tap and the water flows in. But think of it in the East, when you actually buy a drink. You can say, C.K. Barrett, see that the East is a place of waterless spaces. R.H. Lightfoot, in his commentary of John, says water, especially in the hot countries, is one of the most compelling needs of man. In many parts of the world, the word thirst suggests the most passionate and painful craving that a man can undergo. It is the agonized protest of the human body against being deprived of its most vital need, and if unslaked, it is the prelude to the most terrible of deaths. And we don't think of thirst in terms of that at all. We think of thirst in terms that can be satisfied by a cup of coffee or a nice drink or a drink of Coca-Cola or something like that. You're certainly not going to die of it. Now, you see, every time thirst is mentioned in the Bible, we've got to remember this. You get Matthew 5 and 6, the blessing on those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. You get Psalm 42, verses 1 and 2. As the heart longs for the flowing streams, so longs my soul for thee, O God. My soul thirsts for God. Now, this is no pleasant, easy, want-a-drink idea. This is drink or die. And a text like that, a saying like that, asks you, quite simply, how much do you want God? How much do you want goodness? Do you want God? Do you want goodness as much as a man dying of thirst wants water? Do you want it with that desperation? Not just the easy thirst that we know. And first and foremost, we've got to set this in all our thinking about water and thirst in the Bible. It comes from a desperation that we know nothing about, and to thirst for God is to long for God as a dying man longs for water. Now, the second thing that is very obvious about water is that water in the Bible and everywhere else, of course, has a cleansing significance. And because of that, water is at the very essence of Jewish ceremonial law. Now remember what Jewish ceremonial law was. Jewish ceremonial law dealt with what is clean and unclean. Now this idea of clean and unclean had nothing to do with physical and material dirt or anything like that. It was a ritual thing, a matter of taboo. You touched something or you came into contact with something or some person and you became unclean. an unclean man. Not that you couldn't go about your ordinary business, but that you couldn't go to worship. When you were unclean, you couldn't go to synagogue, you couldn't go to the temple. You were unclean in the technical sense of the term. So, remember the scarcity of water, and remember what it must have cost for the washings of the unclean, how seriously they must have taken this uncleanness. Now, you get a lot about this in Leviticus 14 to 17. In Leviticus 14, you get how a man is washed after he is cleansed of leprosy. In Leviticus 15, you get a chapter about washing after various physical discharges. In Leviticus 16, you get the priest washing on the Day of Atonement. In Leviticus 17, 14, and 15, you get washing after a man has accidentally eaten blood. In Numbers 8 and verse 7, you get the setting apart of the Levites by washing. In Numbers 19, 11 to 22, you get the washing necessary after touching a dead body. Now, I want it to be remembered, to remember very carefully, that this washing is ritual washing. And I want it also be remembered very carefully that this washing didn't have a moral effect. That this washing morally was quite useless unless it was accompanied by repentance and sorrow for sin. It was purely a ritual cleansing. Now, in regard to this ritual washing, the most important part of it, as far as we are concerned, was proselyte baptism. When a man entered the Jewish faith from another faith, if he was a Greek or an African or something, he was a proselyte, which means one who has approached. And when he came into the Jewish faith, he had to undergo three things. He had to undergo circumcision, sacrifice, and baptism. Now, after, of course, AD 70, there was no possibility of sacrifice, because in AD 70, the temple was destroyed and there was no more sacrifice, but there was always baptism and circumcision. Baptism, proselyte baptism. Now, unquestionably, proselyte baptism is the background of Christian baptism. And in proselyte baptism, the candidate for entry to Judaism was put into a bath. The bath was filled with water and things, weightier and lighter matters of the law were read to him, and then he was allowed in. Now, this indicates that baptism is cleansing. Now, sometimes you wonder if we know what we're doing when we baptize. You see, if you think of baptism in terms of cleansing, then you're committed to a doctrine of original sin. You take, for instance, the Anglican Book of Common Order. The question that is addressed to the godfathers and godmothers: dost thou in the name of this child renounce the devil and all his works, the vain pomp and glory of the world, with all covetous desires of the same, and the carnal desires of the flesh, so that thou wilt not follow nor be led by them? The answer is, I renounce them all, which is a staggering question asked to an eight-week-old child. Then again you get a prayer just after that. O merciful God, grant that the old Adam in this child may be so buried that the new man may be raised up in him. Grant that all carnal affections may die in him, and that all things belonging to the Spirit may live and grow in him. And finally, we get a prayer near the end of the ceremony, and humbly we beseech thee to grant that he, that is the child, being dead unto sin and living unto righteousness, and being buried with Christ in his death, may crucify the whole man and utterly abolish the whole body of sin. Now, if you're thinking of baptism in terms of cleansing, cleansing from what? This is something that we might well think of, what water and baptism means at all. And if you're taking water and baptism to be a cleansing agent, cleansing from what? Are we thus committed to a doctrine of original sin and the old Adam and things like that? That's for discussion. Now, thirdly, in Hebrew, water symbolizes wisdom quite often. We get this in the authorized version of Psalm 80, verse 5. Those who teach a man wisdom, with the bread of understanding she shall feed him and give him the water of wisdom to drink. Again, in Proverbs 14 and 27, the fear of the Lord is a fountain of life. Again, in Proverbs 13:14, the teaching of the wise is a fountain of life. water equals wisdom. Now, fourthly, in the Old Testament, water stands for God. Psalm 36 and 9, with thee is the fountain of life. Song of Solomon 4 and 15, God is likened to a garden fountain, a well of living water. Jeremiah 2 and 13, they have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters. And Philo, the Jew who related Hebrew to Greek thought, speaks of God as the fountain of living, the primal fountain, the perennial fountain. And to draw from the stream of God is to find life instead of death. So water symbolizes God. Now perhaps fifthly, perhaps more than anything else, water symbolized the law. It's a very, very old passage of Numbers. It's one of the oldest passages in the Bible. Numbers 21, 16 to 18. Spring, O well, and sing to it. The well which the princes dug, which the nobles of the people delved, with the scepter and with their staves. Now that well in Jewish thought was always taken to be equal to the law. So for instance, we find a lot of Jewish rabbinic sermons, which I quote, Sermon Proverbs 4 and 22. My words are life to them that find them. The rabbi said, as water is life for the world, so the words of law are life for the world. Psalm 19 and 8, the commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. Rabbinic comment, as water leads the impure up from his impurity, so the words of the law lead a man from the evil way to the good way. Water equals the law was a very strong Old Testament and rabbinic conception. Then sixthly, there is the connection of water with satisfaction. Of course, we get this most strongly in John chapter 4, verses 7 to 15. In that passage, Jesus has been talking to the woman of Samaria, and he has asked her for a drink, and she has pointed out that he has nothing to drink and nothing to draw with. And Jesus says to her, everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. The water that I shall give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water, that I may not thirst nor come here to draw. Water, satisfaction. Now at the back of this, there's something which is at the back of a great deal of Johannine thought and a great deal of New Testament thought. Now this really comes from Plato. And Plato always thought in terms of two worlds. And in the two worlds there is this. This world is the world of ordinary things. But there is another one. And in this other world there is the world of ideas or forms. And ideas and the forms are the archetypes, the models, the patterns, the perfections of the things on which earth are things on earth are copies. For instance, in the heavenly pleasures there's a chair, of which all earthly chairs are poor copies. So there is this distinction between heavenly water and earthly water. And there is really also the distinction between what you might call heavenly dissatisfaction and earthly dissatisfaction. There is a kind of dissatisfaction, a kind of thirst that earthly water can quench. But there is a deeper dissatisfaction, and that dissatisfaction only Jesus Christ can quench. And this means that in Jesus the real world has come. In Jesus we are not dealing with things which come and go as they do in this world. In Jesus the real world, the world of eternities, the world of realities has come. And the real thirst can be quenched by the real water. Now secondly, very closely connected with this, there is the connection of water and the Spirit. Now we get that particularly in John 7, 37 to 39. On the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and proclaimed, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water. Now this he said about the Spirit, which those who believed in him were to receive. For as yet the Spirit had not yet been given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Now, this happened on the last day of the feast, and the feast is the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, on the last day of the Feast of Tabernacles, there was a ceremony, and at this ceremony, in procession, the high priest went down to the Pool of Siloam with a silver pitcher holding about 2 pints. And at the Pool of Siloam, he drew water. And he carried this water up in the silver pitcher, and when he came to the temple courts, which were crowded with people, he cast this water on the great altar of the burnt offering. Now, this can be two things. The Feast of Tabernacles was a reminder of the time when the children of Israel lived in tents in the desert. And this could be a thanksgiving for God's good gift of water, looking right back to the desert days. Or it could be an acted prayer for water. Now, as they went, they sang Isaiah 12 and 3. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation. Now, think of it. Here's the place crowded with people. Down they go in procession for this, back up they come with it. And it's being flung onto the altar, and just immediately then, in the temple court crowded, Jesus gets up and says, "You're thanking God for the water which will quench a moment's thirst. I offer you the water which will quench your thirst forever." It's back again, the same thing. The eternal come into time, and this comes through the Spirit. The Spirit is the bringer of this satisfaction. This satisfaction, which is like the perfect water, which can quench the deepest needs of life. Now, eighthly, and we come to the last thing, and the last thing is simply this, that water, naturally, in view of this, stands for life. We get this both in the Old and New Testament. We get it in Ezekiel 47 and 9, and we get it in Revelation 22, 1 and 2. In both of these, we get the picture of the river flowing in the streets of the heavenly city. And where the river is, there are fruits and trees. Where there is water, there is life. No water, no life. That was the case in the East. And so water stands for life. And because of that, you get something which is very important. In Isaiah 35 and 7, there is a text which all of us have heard again and again. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. Now, that's a messianic promise. This is the promise of what is to happen when the Messiah comes. And Jesus offers the water of life. And this, therefore, identifies Jesus with the Messiah. And for Jesus to offer the water of life is a messianic promise. So we've got all these many things, that water implies this thirst. Water implies cleansing. Water implies wisdom. Water implies the law. Water implies this satisfaction. Water implies the Spirit, and water implies life. All these things, and just one last thing. There is just very occasionally in the New Testament occasions when water stands for inferiority. We get this particularly in the miracle of the turning of the water into wine at Cana of Galilee in John chapter 2 verses 1 to 11. There, the water in the water pots is turned into wine. Now, the water in the water pots was the water which was kept for Jewish ritual ceremonial purification. And that is to say, it was water demanded by the Jewish law. And under Jesus, the water of the Jewish law turns into the wine of the Christian life. The inferior becomes the superior. The earthly becomes the divine. The temporal becomes the eternal. And therefore, very occasionally, ordinary water is contrasted with the wine of eternity. So water stands for cleansing. It stands for life. It stands for knowledge. It stands for satisfaction. But if I were asked for the one thing that the water symbolism stands for, right to the Bible, it's desire. It's this idea of thirst as a desperate desire for God. Before we begin to study any of the individual parables, There are certain things that we ought to look at and to remember concerning parables in general. First of all, there is just exactly what a parable is. A parable is really a comparison. The word parable comes from two Greek words, para, which means beside, and balein, which means to throw. And things which are thrown side by side are compared, and a parable is a comparison. Now, what's the point of this comparison? The point of this comparison is that by comparing a familiar and an unfamiliar thing, you get a better idea what the unfamiliar thing is. A parable, as someone has said, is a way of getting to the from the here and now to the there and then. See, you think it this way. People aren't very clear as to what the kingdom of God is all about. But they have seen a woman baking, and they've seen a man fishing, and they've seen a farmer at his field, and they've been at a feast. And so you compare the kingdom of heaven with the farmer, with the fisherman, with the woman baking, and by comparing the familiar and the unfamiliar, you get an insight into the unfamiliar you would not otherwise have got. Now that means, for the most part, parables work by resemblance. Things are compared because they're like each other. A very good example of that is, of course, the parable of the prodigal son. In the parable of the prodigal son, God is compared with a loving father who, no matter what the son did, was glad to have him back again. But we have to remember that just now and again, the comparison which is made in the parable is not because the two things are like each other, but because they're a contrast with each other. One very important parable which works by contrast is the parable which is known as the parable of the unjust judge, which we get in Luke chapter 18, verses 2 to 5. That parable tells how there was a woman who wanted justice, and there was an unjust judge who wouldn't give anybody justice unless they brought a large-sized bribe. And so this woman had no money at all, but she did have one weapon. She had persistence until she came back and back and back and back. Till at last the judge got so utterly fed up with her coming back that he gave her the justice that she wanted. And what the New Testament says is that that parable tells us something about prayer. And there are some people who would say that what it teaches us is persistence in prayer. And if you want something, you've got to come back and back and back and back at God. But obviously, you can't really believe that prayer consists in knocking down God's opposition, so to speak. And what this parable does is it works not by resemblance, but by contrast. And what it says is, if an unjust judge can be finally persuaded into giving a woman something that she wants because of sheer persistence, how much more will God, who is a heavenly father, give his people what they need? It doesn't compare God with the unjust judge. It contrasts God with the unjust judge. So remember, in the first place, that a parable is a comparison. It's a comparison by which we hope to get to the unfamiliar from the familiar, to the there and then from the here and now. And sometimes it works not by resemblance, but it works by contrast. The second thing to remember about a parable is of the very greatest importance. Parables were always spoken. There are two kinds of things which are very like each other. There are allegories and parables. The two most famous allegories in the English language are Spenser's Fairy Queen and Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. In an allegory, every single thing in an allegory means something. And you sit down and you've got to transfer this story thing into what it really means. But you do that reading. Now remember, a parable is spoken, and a parable hits you in the eye. And in a parable, there's only one point, and that's the one point that hits you in the face straight away. And it's quite wrong in the case of a parable to make every single thing stand for something. You couldn't do that listening. You can only do that if you sit down and read. So it's been said that a parable is not like a sonnet shaped in seclusion and in quietness. A parable is like the flash of a sword blade. It has one point and one point only. This is something we've got to learn, because people have been all treating the parables for a long, long time. Way back in the 5th century, Augustine gave this interpretation of the parable of the Good Samaritan. Now, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. The man is Adam. Jerusalem is the heavenly city of peace, from the blessedness of which Adam fell. Jericho means the moon and signifies our mortality, because it is born, it waxes, wanes, and dies. He's attacked by thieves. The thieves are the devil and his angels, who stripped him, namely, of his immortality, and beat him by persuading him to sin, and left him half dead, because insofar as man can understand and know God, he lives, but insofar as he is wasted and oppressed by sin, he is dead. He's therefore called half dead. The priest and Levite are the ministry of the Old Testament, and they pass him by, because there's nothing that in the Old Testament which can profit for salvation. Samaritan in Hebrew could mean guardian, and therefore the Samaritan is the Lord himself, the guardian of men. The binding up of the wounds is the restraint of sin. Oil is the comfort of a good hope. Wine is the exhortation to work with a fervent spirit. The beast on which the Samaritan set the poor man is the flesh in which Jesus deigned to come to us. The being set upon the beast is belief in the incarnation. The inn is the church where travelers are refreshed on their journey to the heavenly country. The morrow is after the resurrection of the Lord. The two pence are the commands to love God and to love our fellow man. The innkeeper is the Apostle Paul. And so on and on and on this goes. Now you see, the point is nobody could make these transferences while they were listening. You could only do this if you sit down and read. And in a parable, there's only one point, and the point is the point which hits you between the eyes. But what is the point? See, sometimes it's not entirely clear. For instance, take this parable, Matthew 13 and 33. We generally call it the parable of the leaven. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of flour till it was all leavened. Telling us something about the kingdom, what does it tell us? See, there are some people, some scholars, who would say that what it tells us is that you can't see the leaven working, and you can't see the kingdom working. And the kingdom is silently, unseen, pervasively permeating everything. And so they speak about the kingdom as working by unseen, quiet, pervasive influence. But there are people who say this. See, it's God says it, for instance, that when you put leaven into dough, you get the reverse of quietness. When you get leaven into dough, the dough starts to seize and bubble like a volcanic mass, all bubbling as quickly as possible. And so this lot would say this means that the kingdom of heaven is violent, seething, explosive, disturbing, making things into chaos, at least at the beginning. So you see, you don't entirely solve your problem when you talk about the one point, but you do find that this is the way to approach a parable. The way to approach a parable is to say it's got one point, and that one point is not necessarily the point which would hit me in the eye, but the point which would hit the people who heard it for the first time in the eye. And so in the case of a parable, you've got to learn all you can about the background, all you can about what happened when it was being said, what life was like, what the country was like. Then you've a chance of knowing what it's all about. But that's not the big problem of the parables. The big problem of the parables is in Mark 4, 11 and 12. Now, Mark 4, 11 and 12, let's read it. To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see and not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn again and be forgiven. Now that's the most extraordinary thing, because as it reads just now, it would seem the parables were given by Jesus to obscure his message and to keep people from understanding what he was going to say. When you come to think of it, it can hardly mean that. Now, what does it mean? Well, let's take it to pieces. To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. That's the Revised Standard Version, the Authorized Version. To you has been given the mystery of the kingdom of God. Now, in Greek, a mystery was not something which was difficult and obscure. A mystery was something which was absolutely open to the initiate, but obscure to the people who wasn't initiate. You see, the best example I can think of is this. When I was a minister in Renfrew Trinity Church at a communion time, the children were allowed in the gallery. And when it came to the communion service, I used to see these children in the gallery looking down, giggling and laughing, amused. Because it is funny when you think of it. that a lot of grown people should sit down and eat a cube of bread about the size of a sugar cube and drink a little cup of wine. And so the children found it amusing because they didn't know the meaning, but the initiate, those of us who sat at the table, for us, it was the most sacred of all services of the church. So you see, to you who are inside has been given the meaning of the kingdom of God. And of course the meaning was that with Jesus the kingdom has come. To you who are inside, to you who are initiates, to you who are my friends, the meaning of the kingdom has come. But for those outside, everything is done in parables. In Greek, there's a way of saying in with a noun, and that's equal to an adjective. In grief is grief-stricken. In joy is joyful. The word parables also means an obscure saying. So in parables means obscure, difficult to understand. Now, again, to you who are inside has been given to know the secret, the kingdom of God has come in me, Jesus says. And for those who are outside, everything is obscure. Now, so that they may indeed see and not perceive, and they may indeed hear and not understand, lest they should turn again and be forgiven. Now, that sounds as if Jesus didn't want them to turn again. Let's read it again. So that they may indeed see and not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn again and be forgiven. Now that's a quotation from Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 10. Now listen very carefully to the Isaiah and see if you can see one little bit of difference. Make the heart of this people fat and their ears heavy and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn and be healed. Got it? See, Mark finishes with the words, lest they should turn and be forgiven. Isaiah finishes with the words, lest they should turn and be healed. How did this come about? Well, the Old Testament's in Hebrew, and in the people in Palestine in the time of Jesus didn't understand Hebrew any more than we understand the kind of English Chaucer spoke, Anglo-Saxon. And so in the synagogue, when the Bible was being read, there was a man called the Targumist, and he translated it into Aramaic, which was the language they spoke, sentence by sentence. This part of Isaiah said in the Hebrew that the people, the last bit of it was, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed. That's the Hebrew. But the Targum, the translation that the people listened to all the time, was not and be healed, it was and be forgiven. And so you see, what Mark is quoting, what Jesus is quoting, is not the Hebrew of Isaiah. What they're quoting is the Targum that the people read every day. Now let's go a little further. In this Targum there's another change. Listen. So that they may indeed see and not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn again and be forgiven. Lest. Now in the Hebrew, this word lest is a little word, rather like the English word that, a meaning that can have all, word that can have all kinds of meanings. And in the Targum, it's not translated lest, it is translated unless. Now let's put this together as an ordinary person in the synagogue would understand it. To you who are inside, has been given the ability to see that the kingdom of God has come in me, in Jesus. But for those who are outside, everything is quite obscure. So that they may indeed see and not perceive, and may indeed hear and not understand, unless they should turn again. That's unless they should repent and be forgiven. So this passage doesn't say that Jesus spoke the parables to obscure things. It says he spoke them in such a way that people would only understand when they repented and accepted the forgiveness of God. So these are the three things that before we start on the parables, we must know about all of them. First, a parable's a comparison, sometimes in resemblance, sometimes in contrast. And that comparison is supposed to lead our thoughts from the familiar to the unfamiliar, from earth to heaven, from the here and now to the there and then. A parable is one point because people were listening to it, not reading it and not poring over it. Listening is the point which hits you in the eye. And you understand that point when you know about the background. And thirdly, parables weren't meant to obscure the message of Jesus. Parables were meant to make it possible for common people to understand it. The parable of the sower will always have a special place amongst the parables of Jesus, for according to the gospel record, it was the first parable Jesus ever spoke. It's told in all the first three gospels, in Matthew 13, 3 to 8, and 18 to 23, in Mark 4, 1 to 8, and 15 to 20, in Luke 8, 5 to 8, and 11 to 15. Let's listen to it. On that day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lakeside. Such crowds gathered to listen to him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while the crowd all stood on the shore. He used parables to tell them many things. Look, he said, a sower went out to sow his seed. As he sowed, some seeds fell by the side of the road, and the birds came and snapped them up. Others fell on the ground where there was only a thin skin of earth over the rock. And because the soil was so shallow, they sprang up immediately. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Some fell among thorn bushes, and the thorn bushes shot up and choked the life out of them. Others fell on good ground and produced a crop, some 100 times, some 60 times, some 30 times, as much as had been sown. If a man has ears, let him hear. Listen then to the meaning of the parable of the sower. If anyone hears the message of God's kingdom and does not really understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in such a man's heart. This kind of person is represented by the picture of the seed sown on the side of the road. The picture of the seed which was sown on the ground, which was only a thin skin of earth over the rock, represents the man who hears the word and who immediately receives it enthusiastically. But he has no inner root and he is at the mercy of the moment. And so when trouble or persecution comes, he at once stumbles and collapses. The picture of the seed which was sown among the thorn bushes represents the man who hears the word, but the worry of this world and the deceptive seduction of wealth choke the life out of the word, and it never gets a chance to produce a crop. The picture of the seed which was sown on the good ground represents the man who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears a crop which produces sometimes 100 times, sometimes 60 times, sometimes 30 times, as much as he received. Well then, here's our story, and first of all, let's try to visualize it. There's such a crowd that Jesus has got to sit in one of the fishermen's boats and have the boat pushed out into the lake, and he uses the boat as a pulpit, and from there he speaks. When you look at the Greek, you note a thing which doesn't come out in the English versions very clearly. Because in the Greek, it doesn't speak about a sower, it speaks about the sower. And it says the sower went out to sow. Now in the parable, as we've already seen, Jesus uses the familiar to get to the unfamiliar. And I think what happened was this. As he sat in the boat and looked at the crowd, he saw behind the crowd in a field close to the lakeside a man sowing seed. And he said to the crowd, look, the sower. And from there he goes on to tell them the story, starting exactly from where they were and what they could see. To understand this parable, we need to know something about agricultural practice in Palestine. In Palestine, fields were raked in June, and then they lay fallow until November, when the sowing was done. Now, one point that we just must see in this parable is that in Palestine, oddly enough, the seed was sown before the ground was ploughed. So you've got your field in November. When you've got your field in November, it has been left fallow for quite a long time, and it's got stubble, it has been cut, but it has been grazed, and you've got self-sown thistles, and you've got fibrous weeds, and in Palestine, the common ground was long, narrow strips of ground, and between them, there were paths, which were rights of way, and the paths were beaten as hard as the road by people constantly travelling up and down. So the man walks along, sowing the seed before it's ploughed. Now, of course, the plough had to come at his heels, because if it didn't, the birds would get all the seed and there'd be none left. So the man sows, and the plough comes immediately after him. And some seed falls on the path. That's not even ploughed up, but the birds get that. And some seed falls on what most verses of the Bible call the rocky ground or the stony ground. Now, to us, this seems to mean ground which is full of stones, but that's not what it means in Palestine. In Palestine, it meant ground where there was just a thin skin of earth over a limestone shelf of rock, which was very common. And in this shallow ground, of course, you got a great deal of heat, and a seed would germinate quickly, but there was no moisture, and the plant just withered and died. So, seed that was there and sown on the ground, which was just a skin over the limestone rock, this seed germinated quickly and grew quickly, but it just as quickly died. Then in the field there were places where there were fibrous-rooted weeds. Those of you who have gardens and who work in gardens know it's quite easy to make a garden look decent by cutting the top off the weeds. But if you leave things like couch grass and that kind of thing, fibrous-rooted weeds in the ground, their roots are still there and just as strong as ever. And so some of the seed was sown amongst this kind of stuff. And this kind of stuff was so crowding the earth that the seed had never got a chance to grow. And finally, there was some seed which fell on deep, good, solid, fertile ground. And it brought forth seed some 100-fold, 100 times as much had been sown, some 60 times, some 30 times. Then there is the interpretation of this parable in the later part. Now, the interpretation doesn't go back to Jesus. The interpretation is the interpretation of the early church. The language is not the same as the language of the parable at all. If you study the words and study the structure, this is different, and it's the interpretation of the early church. Now, there's nothing wrong with it because of that. A parable is an expanding thing. It can have an interpretation for those who heard it for the very first time. It can have an interpretation for later times for us today. And that interpretation is perfectly valid for us to look at, although it's not the first interpretation of the parable, but nonetheless, let's look at it, since it's there for the very first time. There was the seed that fell on the path. Now, the path represents the shut mind. It just can't get in. The word just can't get in. The different soils represent different kinds of mind. And the path is the shut mind. Now, what shuts a mind? Certain things shut it. Pride shuts it. If a man thinks he knows it all already, if a student thinks he knows it all already, you can't possibly teach him. Prejudice shuts it. If you think, if you've got a prejudice, then you just won't listen to any other view except your own. Laziness shuts it. A lazy mind just won't think. It won't take the risk of thinking. It's quite satisfied with what it's got, and it won't move. So the path is the shut mind. Then you've got the rocky ground, the thin skin over the limestone rock. That's the shallow mind. And the shallow mind is the kind of mind which finds it very easy to start, but very difficult to keep on. Never thinks things out, never tests them, never submits things to doubt. It gets the front of its mind tickled. Remember Plato. Plato says the unexamined life is the life not worth living. The shallow mind never really examines life. Then there's the thorny ground. Now the thorny ground stands for the crowded mind. I mean, there's so much in this ground that the seed can't get in at all. The crowded mind needn't necessarily be crowded with bad things. A very wise thing was once said, the worst enemy of the best is the second best. When things are really bad, you see that they're bad, but you get a student, and this student's engaged in all kinds of good works, all kinds of laudable things, charitable things, visiting old people and so forth and so on, to the neglect of his studies. which ought to come first. And so the second best tries to crowd out the best. Then there's the seed that falls into the good ground. Now, if you study the three accounts of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you'll find that the people who bring forth the good fruit are said to do five different things. First, they hear. A better translation would be they listen. Stop talking and learn to listen. Just stop talking long enough to hear. They accept. That's to say, they take it in, they allow it to get in. They hold it fast. As I say, it's heard and it's not forgotten. They understand it. That says they find out its meaning for them. They bear fruit. That means they act on it. They don't just hear it, they act on it. This is the good ground. Now, see, the trouble about that interpretation is just that it really makes an allegory out of the parable. You remember when we talked about parables in general, we said a parable has one point. Now, that's at least 4 points. Could you really make these transferences when you're listening? It's easy enough to make them when you sit down. But we said a parable's only got one point. Go back to this parable and think again. Different people have found different points in it. One scholar found in it that the point is the sower. The sower must have courage, patience, persistence, wisdom. He's the central character, the teacher. The teacher must have courage, patience, persistence, wisdom. A second scholar found this point, that the accent is on failure. See, in three cases, the seed failed. Only in the fourth was there a good crop. And so this lesson would be that Christianity is always going to be a minority movement. There's always going to be three times as much failure as there is success. Now, that scholar took what was called the hortatory approach to this parable. He used it as a warning. He seemed to say, look how dreadfully easy it is to lose the seed. Watch yourself, careful, hang on to it all the time. I don't think that any of these things was the point of the parable for the first time. You put this parable in its context when Jesus spoke it for the first time. It's in Mark 4. Go back to Mark 3. Now, in Mark 3, Jesus is involved in three different controversies. He's involved in the controversy about healing on the Sabbath, which breaks the law. He's up against the Orthodox. He's involved in the controversy about the Sabbath, first of all. Then he's involved in the controversy about the exorcising of demons, when the Orthodox Jew says he's doing it with the help of the devil. Then thirdly, he's involved in the controversy with his own family, who come and say he's mad and try to take him home. Now, the disciples have followed Jesus. And at the moment, Jesus is looking like a complete failure. He's up against the Orthodox. The good people of the day will have nothing to do with him. He's even up against his family. And as John tells us later on in John chapter 6, he tells us that at that time, he says, the disciples abandoned him and wanted to follow him no more. And you see, it could be that at this time, the disciples were getting desperately discouraged. There seemed to be nothing but failure on every side, nothing but opposition. And what this parable is saying is, look, no matter how much seed may be lost, the harvest is sure. See, the punchline of the parable is, some brought forth 30, some 60, some 100-fold. And the point is that no matter what failures you've got, no matter how much time and strength and preaching seems to be wasted, in the end, the harvest is sure. And so what the parable says to the disciples, don't be afraid, don't be discouraged. Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 4, says a very wise thing to the farmer or the gardener. He who observes the wind will not sow, and he who regards the clouds will not reap. And if you're too worried about the weather, well, you just won't get any kind of harvest at all. And so I think what this parable said the very first time was this. Don't be discouraged. You may lose some effort, you may lose some seed, but in the end, the harvest is sure. This time we are going to look at the parable which is commonly called the parable of the laborers in the vineyard. It's in Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 to 16. Listen to it. The situation in the kingdom of heaven is like the situation in the following story. There was a householder who went out first thing in the morning to engage workmen to work in his vineyard. He came to an agreement with the workmen to work for a normal day's wage and sent them to his vineyard. He went out again about 9 o'clock in the morning and saw other men standing in the marketplace unemployed. Go to my vineyard along with the other.